All right, so, well, happy Thanksgiving, everybody. This is a good class to ask lots of questions. So let me review some of the stuff that I did at the end of the last hour. And then I think I'll say a few things about non-abuse engaged theory. I'll doubtless have to repeat these Monday because there are so few students here. But it's...
If you don't mind, then you can just do that calculation that you did at the end yesterday, just in complete detail, since no one is here.
All right, well, let's see about that. Let's see where we were last time. What we had found was that the matrix element that takes one from one eigenstate of the Dirac field at time minus t to another at time t. This amplitude is a path integral of e to the I integral L0 to chi p tau of x d chi. Let me write it d chi bar d chi, just because it's easier to do a bar than a star. It really doesn't matter. And we can further think of this as e to the I s0 of chi d chi bar. Here, s0 of chi is an integral of L0 of chi d tau of x, which is an integral, and let me say exactly what that is. It's an integral minus chi bar gamma mu d mu plus m chi d tau of x. Okay, so that's sort of where we ended last time. Now, what we can do is we can imitate what we did for Bose fields. And in the case of Bose fields, what we did was we said that we can turn this into a vacuum state if we multiply this by vacuum chi t, and then chi t e to the minus 2i t h0 chi minus t vacuum, and this is the bare vacuum. My goodness, I didn't think we nearly as many students here today. In fact, a while ago, somebody turned the lights out. Or almost a scene from some horror movie. Anyway, so this on the right-hand side, of course, will just be an integral of 0 chi t ebi s0 chi, chi minus t0 chi bar d phi. I'm using bar and star interchangeably here. There might be some overall factor, but the factor's going to cancel when we do ratios of path integrals. It is always a good time to ask questions, but especially today since there are fewer students. Not that it matters. Also, I bought fresh chocolate at Costco yesterday, so I have something like, I don't know, it's an incredible amount of chocolate. So in a sense, you already asked a question. How did you see them get to them when they hold like one of these plastic bags, modern packaging, you know, pervious?
Too much work. It's got too much work.
Okay, so this is what we've got, and we're going to be integrating this over. I might as well, I guess, put the integration differentials in the front because there isn't any room in the back. So I'll just integrate over d chi bar t d chi t d chi bar minus t d chi bar minus chi minus t on the left, and so now the integral on the right is over absolutely all gauge fields then. And once we do this integration, what we get is the Bayer vacuum, well, the vacuum of this theory, of that Hamiltonian, minus 2i h 0 0, and then we get that this is then integral to equal to this thing 0 chi t e to the I s 0 chi chi minus t 0 d chi bar d chi. And now the same logic here tells us that we could have something like chi bar of t e to the minus I t h 0, and let me do it, say, with two fields, psi of x1, let us say psi bar of x2, e to the minus I t h 0, I minus t. So let's just think about that. We can rewrite this, and I'm thinking of this for the case where t1 is greater than t2, so that these things are time ordered. Then this is e to the minus I t1 minus t2 h0 psi bar x2 0 psi x1 0, where these are now the spatial, simply spatial. I'm sort of repeating the stuff that I did earlier, but in this for scalar fields. And this then has an e the minus I, and this will be T2 plus T H0 chi minus T. And then over here, we have minus I, so we're going to have E to the I, and then it'll be E to the minus I T minus T1 H0 chi bar T. So this structure up here is equal to this. And now, if we do to this what we did to this in order to get the path integral, that is to say, we insert these eigenstates of the Fermi operators over and over again, then this thing, which is chi bar t, e to the minus I t h0, time order product of psi x1 psi bar x2 e minus I t a 0 chi minus, I don't know why I put a bar. This thing then is going to be an integral, and it's going to look like this integral over here, with the exception of the fact that it's going to have these various psi's in there. So it's going to have chi of x1 chi bar of x2 e to the I s0 chi t chi bar d chi. So that's what it's going to look like. And I'm leaving out any math from any overall normal. causation factors. Questions?
So what exactly did you do over there? You said you're going to do the same thing.
Opened it.
No, I mean.
It defeated you as well?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ.
You have a pen there? You.
Pen is mightier than the sword.
All right, well. Here, what would you like? Huh? Here, just pick one you like. All right. Okay, so. So let's see, you had a question there.
Yeah, I just was wondering what exactly were you doing. So you said you're going to do the same thing. And what does the same thing mean?
You mean to go from there to there?
Yeah, what exactly are you doing?
All right, what we're going to be doing then is inserting. Remember that in this coherent state representation here. Now, actually, I have to clarify something. In the paper that Glauber and I wrote, what we used instead of psi was the annihilation operator. In other words, we were doing basically a Fourier decomposition of all Fermi fields. And in fact, we were just focusing on fermions, representing them by, say, a creation operator on the vacuum that gives you a fermion. That may be the best way to do path integrals for fermions, but also even for bosons, because then the coherent states are normalized, they're well-behaved, and they're typically of finite energy. And so, whereas the states that are used in the conventional treatment, and which I used here, partly for simplicity and partly to resemble the conventional treatments, those states are like the Q states of quantum mechanics. They're non-normalizable, they're of infinite energy, and so forth. And when you've got something that's already is mathematically elaborate, let me say, precarious as the path integral, it's probably a good idea to do the derivation with states that are as calm as possible, rather than ones that are already of infinite norm and infinite energy. The price you pay for that is that you're always in Fourier space, which, when you do perturbation theory, is actually probably an advantage. So that was an aside. To get back to your question, remember that what we said was the following. This was our representation of the identity operator. So you can stick, you split, you look at this formula rather than this. And what you see here is that you've got the same thing as here,
yeah,
except that this e to the minus 2ith0 has been spread so that most of it's here, but a little bit of it's in between the two fermion operators. And then when you stick in these identity operators and chop this thing up into time segments of length epsilon, this part just gives you an integral, a path integral of the action, or of the Lagrange density. And then when you hit this, you just get an eigenstate. In other words, you have a sidebar x2 chi integrated from an identity operator, and this turns into chi bar of x2. And then you have some more path integral here, and then you have psi of x1, and it hits a chi, in another identity, identity operator, and this turns into chi of x1. And then all the other factors of e to the minus ih0 just become parts of this little epsilon segments of this pattern. So the upshot is that you get this. Where now the path integration is from all fields that start here and end there. Actually, I'm fibbing a bit, because that would be exactly the case if these states were had delta function normalization. Instead, you really integrate over all fields here, but you have a matrix element at the end, and the matrix element is chi t chi. Chi t minus t, because these things aren't zero in the coherent state representation. Well, that's a slight complication. All right, so now what we do, though, so we've got this formula here, that this time-ordered product is equal to this. So now we do the same thing we did over there. We multiply by zero chi t, and then e to the minus I t h zero time ordered product of psi one, psi bar two, e to the minus I t h zero chi minus t zero. And we integrate d chi t, d chi minus t, and d chi bar t, d chi bar minus t. We integrate over all of them. This gives us simply vacuum e to the minus I t h zero time ordered product psi one psi two bar. E to the minus I t h zero vacuum, okay, integrating over the intermediate states there. On the right hand side, we've got this structure. So this is equal to an integral, and now it's going to be, it's going to look very much the same, because if these things aren't completely orthogonal, then we have chi t chi. And then we have chi of x1, chi bar of x2, e to the I s0 of chi, and then we have some other chi. This chi has nothing to do with that chi, of course. Chi minus t, 0, and then chi bar, d chi. And now, we integrate over everything, and so this gives us what we might as well say is simply this. Now we integrate over everything, but we've got these matrix elements at the end. And over here on the left-hand side, we've got this. And that expression we're supposed to be comparing to this expression over here. And in each case, well, in this particular case, we can compute the left-hand side exactly. It's just e to the minus 2i t e0, because the ground state's normalized. Over here, what we're going to get is e to the minus I 2 t 0 times, so psi of x1 psi bar of x2 vacuum. And that's equal to this. And so what we get is vacuum time ordered product psi x1 psi bar x2 is then a ratio of path integrals, and the one path integral is 0 pi psi of x1 psi bar of x2 EVI F0 of pi. Whoops. I always keep forgetting that other term there. Pi 0. Pi bar D pi. But then we have to divide by the thing on the right hand side, which was this. And this, when we put in effectively this factor there, what we get is 0 pi pi 0 e to the I as 0 of pi e pi bar e pi. Okay, so that's, I did it for the case of just two fields, but you can see that we had more than two fields, you could have, in other words, the structure more generally is vacuum time ordered product psi of x1 dot 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 psi of xn psi bar of xn plus 1 psi bar x. And in fact, this doesn't have x, let us just say n plus n. That's going to be then a ratio of integrals 0 chi, and now chi of x1, chi of xn, chi bar of xn plus 1, chi bar of xn plus n, e to the I S0 pi pi 0 to pi bar d pi. Okay, so that's what we get in a fairly straightforward way. Now, if we had been using the coherent states for fermions as in this paper that I posted on the webpage, then we'd be able to compute this pretty easily because this would just be essentially e to the minus a half chi bar chi.
But just a Gaussian.
Right. Gaussian and Grassmannian Gaussian.
Yeah.
Here, what we would have to do is to derive what this is in the particulars for the states, the coherent states that we have here, and it would presumably be something similar to that, involving instead some derivatives and so forth. So that might even be another reason to switch and use that other formalism. Let me mention one other thing. Somebody asked a question about eigenstates of the coherent. Well, for the case of bosons, you don't have simple eigenstates from the right of the creation operator. But for fermions, you can, especially if you use the coherent state representation. And then they're defined very much analogously to the coherence, to the eigenstates of the annihilation operators. they're just eigenstates then of the fermionic creation operators. And they're all defined in terms of a state that we call one, which was a state of the form psi dagger, product of psi daggers on some state G, some state that's not annihilated by all of these guys. And in fact, since we were dealing with, this would be what the analog would be in our formalism. The analog, what we did was we had a product, a dagger, on some G. We called this the state.
What are we claiming about the state one? We are claiming that it is an eigenstate of creation?
No, we're saying that this plays the role of the vacuum, and
okay.
And we can then generate from this eigenstates of a dagger. It's in the, it's clearly explained. All right.
And what exactly is the reason for this? I mean,
for what?
For allowing, the reason that we are able to have eigenstates of a dagger?
Well, it's just the mathematics allows it, but
what exactly in the mathematics is it?
Huh?
What exactly in the mathematics allows it? Is it just that these are transmutations that they don't do anything? What exactly?
Lord. All right, hold on. In fact, these things are very simple. These eigenstates would be the following. We call them alpha prime. They're just displacement operators on this state one.
The displacement
which again is defined like this.
The regular displacement operator.
In fact, the way we define these things is we took this thing to be zero, actually.
Zero is in the vacuum?
Yeah.
Okay.
And
so this is not the same vacuum that you were talking about yesterday. This is the actual vacuum.
The actual vacuum of the free Hamiltonian, yeah, the thing that's annihilated by all the state, all the annihilation operators.
And this displacement operator, what is the form of it? Is it?
All right, hold on. Let's talk about, say, D of gamma. And this would be e to the sum on I, ai daiga, gamma sub I minus
okay, so
gamma sub I star ai.
It's the same as the quantum of this.
Yes, absolutely, except that, yeah, everything is completely parallel. It was remarkable the extent to which it's parallel. Right, we even had S-ordered operators. We were surprised that everything went through this.
So the quasi probability distribution also.
Yeah. It's just printed out. It's on the web. All right. Anyway. So let's see. Get back at what we were doing here. All right, well, the next thing is to say that these things, these factors here, effectively just introduce an I epsilon into the denominator of the propagator. Okay. And In order to show that, what we have to do is do the calculation on Kai's vacuum, and I actually did not do this. For coherent states, we know what it is, but in some case, I'm not sure. But it's presumably something like some normalization factor, e to the minus some integral, chi bar, if we're in Fourier space, chi bar of p, some differential operator, and so let me just call this d of p, chi of p, dqp. So it's something of this basic form where this thing is going to be strictly positive. In fact, it would probably be something like, remember in the case of spinless bosons, this was essentially square root of p squared plus m squared. So it's probably something like that. But I did not derive it over the last couple of days. In any event, all we need is, we eventually suppressed the form of this and just said that it was some positive function. Weinberg also doesn't say what it is. Anyway. Another reason for doing the coherent state, the real coherent state representation. Maybe I should. Anyhow, so this.
So why don't these people do it in the real coherent state picture? I mean, is it in the coherent state?
You mean why in all the other treatments of pattern integration?
Yeah, why do they? Is it because these states are the thing occur?
I'm sorry, finish this. I didn't quite hear the end of the sentence.
So do you think that these are more physical states, or, and what is?
Well, let's put it this way. One advantage of doing things the conventional way is, suppose you start in just ordinary quantum mechanics. Then your Hamiltonians are always the form ordinary, non-relativistic, single particle quantum mechanics. They're always in the form p squared over 2m plus v of q. So it is easier to use the pq eigenstates to set up the path integral. And one reason is that then you integrate over p and you've got p gone, you just have q, and then you interpret that as an integral over all paths q. Here's I'm going to title it. Anybody else hungry or inquisitive? All right. So that's one reason. A second reason is if you do things in terms of eigenstates of the annihilation creation operators, which are defined in Fourier space, then there isn't really a problem. Well, yeah, the fields, you see, it's not that the fields, if you do things in the coherence, in the coherent state way, then if you have some field psi of x, and you have some, say, coherent state alpha, it's only the positive frequency part of this that gives you some chi of x and alpha on alpha. And so what happens is when you have the inner product of beta psi of x alpha with two different coherent states, then you get some chi of x alpha and beta star. So it's a little more complicated. Whereas doing things the conventional way, you have psi of x, if it's a boson, you have phi of x, phi is say 5 prime is 5 prime of x, 5 prime, and if it's a Fermi operator, I use pi and just get a different letter so I didn't have to prime everything. It looks like this. So this is neither doing the derivation. The mathematics is probably more solid if you do it with real coherent states, I would guess.
But then you'll have other integrals. You won't be bothered about this kind of...
Right, this thing comes out automatically at the end.
But you still have these other kind of integrals where you have mixing of these positive...
Yeah, but then we finesse that, you see. The finessing is because what we're going to say here is this beta differs from alpha by only epsilon. And so effectively, this is, you're sort of going to identify alpha with beta, basically. So it's going to be essentially the same. All right, so we're at 6.11 here. Let me see what else I've got. I've LaTeX'd some of this, but not all of it. All right, well, let's assume that what do I have on the left? Okay, that's nice. On the right, let's assume that the effect of these is just to put in the epsilon. And so in that case, we have integral pi of x1, pi of xn, pi bar of xn plus 1, pi bar of xn plus m. And I'm really sorry I chose chi. Never choose chi. It looks like x, and everything in physics and mathematics is x. So now we have x0 pi and epsilon, pi bar and pi, and we divide by integral e dy s0 pi and epsilon, pi bar pi. Okay. All right, the next thing is to introduce z0 of zeta, and that's the time-ordered product of e to the I integral zeta bar psi. In fact, let's might as well put in the arguments. I suppressed them in the in the LaTeX because I just couldn't fit, the equations got too big if I put the x's in. And so just using this formula, we see that this is nothing more than the integral e to the I zeta bar of x, but now pi of x plus pi bar of x zeta of x e to of x plus I S0 chi and epsilon e chi bar d chi, and then in the denominator we have just the I integral S0 chi and epsilon e chi bar d chi. Now, obviously, z0 of 0 is equal to class take a wild guess. What is this for zeta equal to 0?
1.
Right. So that's worth a thought. I don't know how many said 1. And there's not to leave out the crazy. Huh?
Is it a Thanksgiving tree? Is it a Thanksgiving tree?
Well, you called that if you want. I did buy fresh chocolate yesterday. All right, so so what happens now is that you can, now I haven't LaTeX these notes, and I haven't even, to be completely honest, I'm thinking, by the way, of assigning the following as a homework problem. Assuming either the correct form for this or a sort of generalized form for this, have you guys derived the Feynman propagated from this? I don't know whether it's basically you just imitate the previous stuff. In other words, what you have, all right, here, let me do some of it. Here. What you have here is S0 of pi and epsilon is an integral minus, and I'm using the Weinberg metric. So this is chi bar gamma mu du plus m pi t4 of x. So that's S0. And then there's going to be minus pi epsilon chi bar some f of grad, I don't know what it is, chi t4 of x. So I'll assume the epsilon terms give us this. And actually, I think this is a plus sign. Because what I want is that this thing should altogether equal an integral minus chi bar. Well, first I'm going to introduce a, go to Fourier transform space. And of course, the curious thing is that as soon as you go to Fourier transform space, what I was about to say, you get to these eigenstate, you get to the annihilation creation operators, but of course the annihilation operators are in three-dimensional Fourier transform space rather than four-dimensional Fourier transform space. But anyway, here, let's just call, say, chi of x is an integral e to the I px, chi of p, e to the p over 2 pi over 4. You can imagine a tilde on this if you want. And so then S0 of chi epsilon is an integral minus chi bar of p, well, chi bar of q, e to the minus I qx, gamma mu, I p mu plus m, chi of p, e to the I px, d4th p, d4th q, d4th x, y to the a. And I want a minus I epsilon here. And so that means this thing has to be a plus, and this is some f of p. So it's minus I epsilon, some f of p. And we'll just think of the f as something like square root of p squared plus m squared. When you do the d4th x integration, you get a delta function times 2 pi to the fourth. And so this gives us integral minus chi bar of p, I gamma mu p mu plus m minus I epsilon chi of p, d4th p over pi to the fourth. And I'm still wondering whether I should give this as a, the rest of this. So from here on, why don't I make that a homework problem? Eventually show if you can compute then what, just imitate the notes for bosons and compute zero time order product. Because this is really unfair to the students who missed this class, isn't it? There is a video. Hi, students.
We usually talk and...
What's that?
I said we're usually doing this stuff together anyway.
Oh, okay. All right, so the idea would be to compute that and ideally you'd get it into the thing in Weinberg notation and then say in Peskin-Schroeder notation it's this. So...
What was F, that F in the action?
Well, that function was something like this.
I'm sorry, what was the question?
The function F of delta or whatever.
Well, that's what I don't really know. I think it's something like square root of 3 vector p squared plus m squared.
Okay.
But I'm not sure because I don't think I've ever seen it. And again, an advantage of doing things in the coherent state, the ordinary coherent state way, which is to say, as in the paper, is that you wind up with know what that is easily. But one can derive this. And all right, so let me. I think I'm going to stop now because I think this is far enough to push this, and I thought that it would be fun to just start on a video engaged because I'll just do it over again on Monday. But this is the sort of stuff that you want to see more than once. And so, but let's see, you asked a question. Are there any other questions? All right, so this non-abelian gauge theory is really, really, really very amusing and interesting and nice. It's one of the, it was basically invented by Yang and Mills. And I think they did it back in the 50s, actually, sometime in the 50s. And they were thinking of it. What often happens is that a theoretical development is advanced as a way of, as being relevant to some particular problem in physics. And then by the time the theoretical development is appreciated, it's realized that that problem in physics wasn't the right problem to work on anyway. And, but if they had just advanced the thing as a nice idea, nobody would have cared, and the journal editors might have said, oh, send it to the Journal of Mathematical Physics, don't bother us with this. As it was, I don't think anybody paid attention to it for several years. And what they were thinking of was the pion-nucleon interaction. All right, well, let's think about a field representing some kind of bosons or fermions, and it'll have various components, L of X, and I'm going to write this simply as psi of X or as psi, so I'm going to use vector and matrix notation. Let me tell you, in indices are the enemies of understanding, and that's particularly true in Yang-Mills theory. You want to know where they are and be able to write them down, but the matrix notation is vastly better. Okay. So the idea is that you have a transformation called a gauge transformation like this, where G is an element of the gauge group. So if this L goes from 1 up to N, then this is an N by N matrix. Okay. we've just been talking about a gauge theory in which G is just a 1x1 matrix. In other words, e to the I q lambda of x, to make things really. So for n equals 1, you can just have a phase change on the field. And this is basically e to the I theta of x, where theta is not grasping here. So on the other hand, I suppose we could ask, what happens if instead of an ordinary Yang-Mills group, you have a grasping Yang-Mills group? I suppose that's been worked out, but I've never seen it in the literature. Would you use it? Thinking of this as just an ordinary angle, but one that depends upon x. So this is the ordinary E and M gauge transformation. But more generally, you've got an N by N matrix. And the favorite kind is SUN. But it can be anything. In fact, I wrote a paper where it was GLNC, which is the most general N by N gauge group that I did. All right. Now, the problem that people had with, first of all, the problem in even making a gauge theory of the U1 group, which is electromagnetism, is that your action is of the form d mu. Your action will involve something like d mu psi. And you see, if psi prime is e to the I theta psi, then d mu psi is e to the I theta d mu psi plus d mu e to the I theta times psi. So there's this extra term, and you need to compensate for that extra term. And in the case, and what compensates for it in the case of electrodynamics is a gauge field a mu. So the question that Yang-Mills answered was, what do you do if this is, say, this gauge group is, say, SU2? That's the case they considered. But obviously what they did for SU2 is immediately and trivially generalizable to SU1. All right, so the answer in both the U1 and the other case is to define some covariant derivative. So you go from d mu to capital D mu, and you want to say the d mu of psi of x. Of course, let me just emphasize that this problem occurs only if theta depends upon x. And this here, this, and or equivalently, when if g depends upon x. That means that the gauge transformation is local. It varies from place to place.
But why do we want to compensate for, I mean, if it is present, it is present, and shouldn't it have some observable effects?
What we want is we want the Lagrange density to be invariant under this transformation.
Oh, okay.
Excellent question. I owe you a candy. I'll get it when I get to that end of the room. All right. So what we want is that this prime, which is d prime mu g of x psi of x, we want to be equal to g of x d mu psi of x. Okay? Because if it is, then it's easy to have something that's symmetrical. All you do is you take d mu psi Or better yet, I'll raise one of these dmus. Dmu psi dagger, dmu psi, and now this thing prime becomes dmu psi g dagger g dmu psi. Okay? And then this is 1, so this is dmu psi dmu psi. So you get the invariance of the kinetic part of the action if you write the action in terms of a covariant derivative that has nice transformation properties.
I just had one more question. So in general, if I have, say, a non-local Hamiltonian, that is the Hamiltonian has terms which are of a psi at one location and the derivative at another, then I would be able to distinguish between these two theories.
Then you have, then you're really... Then you've got something that's more complicated than what I'm talking about.
But I will be able to distinguish between the two theories, right? And you will know that. Well, I'll be able to see the phases or whatever, the phase differences.
Well, what two theories are you saying?
No, I misspoke. What I mean is I'll be able to see the difference between these phases at two locations if I just don't, if I have a Hamiltonian which has, say, a psi of x1 and a del mu psi of x2, then I'll have an e to the I theta of x1 plus a theta of x2.
Well, the idea is that you want to be able to have, you want an action that's invariant under the transformation.
Yes.
If you have the fields at different points in yes. space-time, then you've got to have something that compensates. One thing that compensates, actually, would be, well, to tell you the truth, it's a line integral. It's an integral e to the a mu of x, dx mu with an I, going from, say, x1 to x2. So you could make something like that. That would be invariant. Of course, I haven't explained why it's invariant because I haven't even introduced a mu, but you're asking questions right ahead of the picture. Let me get back to this. Let me get back to the story. So we want d. We want the derivative to transform simply. That is to say that d mu of psi after the gauge transformation is just g of x d mu of psi. But we know that d mu of psi after the gauge transformation is going to be a d prime mu times g of x psi of x because psi prime of x is g of x psi of x. And g is an n by n matrix, psi is an n vector. All right, well, this tells us what's going on, namely that g d mu should equal d prime mu g, or the d prime mu, and I'm going to put an argument x in there, it sounds silly at the moment, but is equal to g d mu of x, g inverse. And in fact, these are g of x's. Okay? So this is what we want. And now we're going to take a guess that this is like in electrodynamics. It's d mu plus a mu, where I'm absorbing any constant here into the definition of a mu. So that says d mu plus a mu prime should be g d mu plus a mu g inverse. And, well, the d mu can act on the g inverse, or so let me multiply that out for you. This is then d mu plus g d mu g inverse plus g a mu g inverse. So you cancel the d mu's from both sides, and you get that we're all fine as long as a mu transforms in the following way. It's g a, in fact, the whole point of this is that things depend upon the space-time point. So let me put the x in the g. So it's g of x, a mu of x, g inverse of x, plus g of x, d mu, g inverse of x. So this is how the gauge field has to transform. And that means that a mu is an n by n matrix. And it transforms in this particular way. Well, let me see what the time is. What sort of an a mu would that be? What? In other words, it has to stay an a mu when it does this. Okay. Well, the thing that stays invariant under this kind of a transformation, one thing that does is the Lie algebra. So in other words, it's natural to think that this a mu of x is equal to the generators, some generators of the Lie algebra TA times a mu of x. Moreover, the group elements, you know that the group elements can always be written as, well, I'm saying always, certainly near the identity, and you know, there are funny groups that are disconnected and you can't get from the identity to some parts of the groups in a straight way. So
what are
AA's? Huh?
The capital A and the capital A.
What is this?
Yeah, what are those?
Those are the gauge fields. So the individual gauge fields are the things that multiply the generators. These generators then are n by n matrices, but just simply matrices. In fact, let me quickly do this part. You see, G inverse can be written as something like e to the i, oh, I don't know. Theta ATA. In other words, it's some exponential of the generators. That's what a group element is, at least if it's.
The thetas depend on x's?
Huh?
The thetas depend on x? What depends?
Yes. Bingo. In fact, the trouble is, I shouldn't have used theta because theta suggests Grassmann at this point in the course. What do I call them? Alpha of x, ta, and it's alpha a of x thing. Let's give an example. And, all right, so then when you take the derivatives of that, what that pulls down is something with t's, and then the g and g inverse hit that, and then it just throws it into something else in the Lie algebra. All right, so let's go over here and do the example, in fact, the example that Yang and Mills invented. What they had was the g of x was ei, let us say, a of x vector dot Pauli matrices over 2. Okay, so this is a G then is an element of the group SU2. It's a 2x2 matrix. And then this A mu is a sum A equals 1 to 3 TA. A mu of x. All right, so that's the case of SU2.
TA is sigma, you know?
Huh?
TA is sigma, you know?
Yeah.
TA. Oh, I'm sorry, yes. Thank you. Enjoy.
So what are we calling as the elements of the Lie algebra? What are the elements of the Lie algebra?
G is in the group. G is the gauge group.
Yes.
Which here is SU2.
Yes. And what is in the Lie algebra? Where is the Lie algebra? What is the?
The Lie algebra. This is my notes. The chapter on group theory.
I'll do it tonight.
All right. The idea is the following: the TA. For a general Lie group, this is IFABCTC. These things are called the structure constants.
Yes.
This is the commutator. These are n by n matrices. This is an n by n matrix.
Yes.
And these are the generators of the Lie group.
Yes.
Okay. It must be lower density. Okay, for SU3, you have g of x is e to the I some, well, I'm using a for three different things as usual. K equals 1 to 8. Lambda k, and in fact it's usually said to be lambda k times I'll say alpha k of x. Okay, so this is an element of the group SU3. These lambdas are 3x3 matrices. These are called the Galman matrices. And in this case, A mu is a sum k equals 1 to 8, lambda k over 2, A k mu of x. And so in the case of QCD, the standard model theory of the strong interactions, these are the 8 gluon fields. Okay. Now, to go back to the standard model, there is a group SU2, and these fields here in the standard model, they might be written as B mu, which is sigma A over 2.
So this particular form of the gauge field is happening because we are claiming that these the sigma A's, for example, are going to be within the set of sigma A's under this particular gauge under this particular group. So because we want GA G inverse to again be an A, and
right, we want that under this kind of a transformation, and there's a word for it, but I don't
conjugation.
Remember what, huh?
Conjugation.
That's a good word for it. That's probably the correct word for it. Thank you. So under a conjugation, we want this thing to remain in the same mathematical space. And the space that, there may be other examples. In fact, there are other examples. If this were just an element of the gauge group, then under GG inverse, it would stay as an element of the gauge group. But one can be more specific and simpler and say it's just some linear combination of the generators. And then it stays a linear combination of the generators under this transformation.
Yes. That's obvious.
And the reason for that is that anything near the identity is of the form
and then we can use the commutator.
anything, any group, anything near, and in fact conventionally we introduce an I. So it's some small number epsilon, or in fact, why don't I just say this? So a bunch of small numbers epsilon times the generator is an I, a 1. This is some, this is G near the identity. Okay, now I wrote that down, but I did that for a reason. Something over here told me that I should give that as an example, but I forget what were we talking about. I don't remember why this is.
So this is just that if we apply this and onto A's, then the A's will keep, and they'll just be linear combinations of the TA's, and so you continue to scale.
All right, we can see it easily here. All right, yeah. If this is something near the identity, so let me call it G of epsilon, then G of X, G of epsilon, G inverse of X is still some G of epsilon prime, because you, and the reason for that is that G of X, G of epsilon is G of epsilon prime, G of X multiplying from the right. And so epsilon is tiny, so both of these are essentially G of X. And they differ from G of X by just some small thing. So it's basically G of X 1 plus I epsilon A TA is equal to 1 plus I epsilon prime A, let's say B, TB G of X. And so depending on what G of X is, you can figure out what the epsilon prime is giving the epsilons, given the epsilons. And in fact, it's not all that hard to do, because if you just go back to this equation, 1 plus I epsilon B prime TB, you just say G of X, G of epsilon, G inverse of X, minus the identity, which is the n by n identity in general, this thing times T C, say, trace, has to be by this equation, I trace epsilon prime B TB TC, and you normally arrange that these things are both orthogonal, and so this is I some K, some normalization constant, delta AB, and so this is epsilon prime, delta BC, epsilon prime C. So here's a formula for epsilon prime C. It's just you have to compute this trace of that thing minus 1 times TC and so on. All right, well, we're way over time. But I think I've told you the basic idea of Yang-Mills theory, but obviously there's more to it. And I'll review all that Monday. And we were saying that I could assign this as a homework problem because they could watch the video. Tom Hessman on vacation, the video isn't going to be up until Monday. Anyway, you might as well stop the tape.